Hello. So the next piece of equipment I want to take a look at and hopefully make working again is this Danish made, I guess, a frequency generator from Elektrokontroll in København. This piece of equipment has been used on an old submarine here in Norway, as I have been told from the previous owner. So unfortunately the glass front here got cracked under a shipment to me. So either I will glue the pieces together again or make a new one, we'll see. But first I want to make sure that it's fixable and I can make it work again. So yeah, let's take it apart and see what we find inside. So I will start with taking out these glass pieces here. Try not to cut myself. Then I think there is, I see 14 flathead screws around the case here. So I wonder if I have to take them out, for most likely the whole back case here just lifts off. Or is it split in two? Or three parts? Yep, we have a split here. So maybe just need to remove the screws on the back here to take off the back cover. Try to take off these two screws here and see what will happen then. So hopefully nothing has rusted and got stuck. Looks a bit too easy that I just have to remove these two screws. I think I have to remove all the screws around. There, the whole unit fell apart. That was not the plan. And we have some glass. I I wish I had smell-o-vision, because this unit smells old electronics. Cut the power cord here. So the whole back case came right off. So here is inside the frequency generator, or wave generator, or I'll figure it out. Quite dusty and some old spider webbing. It looks like somebody has changed some of the caps at one time. Or not. They're made in Denmark. Try to tip it on its head without breaking anything. So it's some calibration holes, maybe. There's some circuitry inside here. The beefy electrolytic capacitor. And you can switch between 127 and 220 volts AC input. We have a couple of tubes. So if I'm able to make this working again or not, that we'll see. Most certainly start with removing some dust inside there. It'll be some job to access the front panel glass. So I'll try to clean it up a bit, then I'll be back. Okay, so before cleaning anything up, I took the front cover off, so I can get out all the glass pieces that are broken. And when I took the cover off, this plate was sitting here and covering up these frequencies. So as you can see, it's Droitwich, Kalundborg, Vigra, Denmark, and underneath it was Paris, Oslo, Vigra, Malmö, Malmö in Sweden, Denmark. Kalundborg is most likely Swedish channel. Droitwich is a German place, I think. So I have cleaned the unit up. So Now we can take a closer look at the circuit and see if we find anything fault that shines out obvious. So the glass front here is taken off, so I have to figure out how to make a new one. And take a closer look at these bulbs and see if we have to change them. So we have a couple of tubes, ECH4 Philips mini watt tube, a bit unusual socket. Let's see if I can place it there. And we have a tube inside here. That's a Philips mini watt EBF11. So and a tube here. That's a mini watt. It's an EC40 Philips tube. That sits here. So hopefully all the tubes are working, so I don't have to chase and hunt for a new one. So we can try to take a look underneath the unit. I just have to make sure I don't crush the tube there. So I'll change the... Here we can take a look here first. So this switch says mod UDV in INDV. So it's invendig, utvendig. It stands for inside, outside. I'm not sure what this means. Some kind of transformer. It's not so easy when you don't have the schematic for a unit. Or I don't have any user manual either, so I have to figure it out myself. So I'll change the camera view. So here we are under a unit, so I have to take off some out some screws. There. No schematic here either. So I hoped the schematic was inside the case, but it wasn't. And that's a bit weird when it's on military equipment. Usually they are well documented and has something to reference inside the casing. So here is where the magic happens. So all the switches on the front here are connected through
here, so you can see the movement here when I touch the switch. So this is has to be some pre-calibrated frequencies that are displayed on this table here. So and I have calibrated for their own frequencies. So here you can see the movement when I touch the switch. So everything looks to be fine inside here. Nothing burnt or anything obvious that could be wrong. And we have an adjustment here. So I'll not touch anything now. I will not recap this unit in the first place because I want to see if I can power it up as it is. Then I can take a decision later on if I want to recap it or if it is worth doing anything more on. So everything is so beautiful put together. So it's almost a work of art, if you ask me. I love taking apart this old test equipment. So I have yet to find a date code on this instrument. And then I was saying outside, inside. It's most likely external and internal mod. So you switch between external and internal. So this switch is AFBR, stands most likely for afbryter or off switch. So I guess this is an on-off switch. Wonder if I'm going to just change the power cord, or I can just, so the power cord isolation is quite crusty, so it's not worth trying to use this old cord. So I have to take off that and replace it with new cord. So it goes up here, so this is an on-off switch, as I said, because the power cord comes here, so we can power the unit on these two points most likely. So Mr. Carlson will most likely pull off his hair when he sees that I am powering up the unit without changing all the old caps and everything. But I will try to do it slowly and with my dimbal tester, so I don't make any more damage than I have to the unit. So I will heat up my soldering iron and I can just snip them off for now. And just cut off the power cord here. So I'll just set up the unit with my isolation transformer and my dimbal tester. Then I'll be back. So I hooked up my Fluke so we can monitor the current. And I have connected the input after a switch, so I don't have to turn off or on the switch here. So just pouring on the Varioc. It's all the way on the bottom. I still see 1 milliamp. So I'm smelling a short hair. But we'll crank it up and see if the bulb lights up. So crank it up to 80 volts, so we can display the voltage on the meter here. So there we are at 80 volts, and I will let it sit for a while. And so the tubes can get used to some voltage again. You can already see the bulbs inside here is lighting up. Try to zoom in on it. So both the bulbs are lighting up. So I'll let it sit for a while, and I'll be back. So it has been sitting for a while now, and the current has stabilized at 44 milliamps. So I'll try to crank it up even more, so we can take it up to 120 or 50 volts. It all depends on what I see here. If I see a huge spike in the current, I will quickly turn it off. So the bulb here starts to light up a bit, but that's not weird. It's quite... I think I need to switch to the other bulb here. There. So we are at 70 milliamps and 130 volts. Try to crank it up to 150. There. We are at 150 volts and 86 milliamps, and I will let it sit for a little while again. So the bulbs here are getting brighter. So at 150 volts for a while now, and we can see the tube is heating up. About 50 degrees C, and the other one is also heating up a bit. So that's nice to see. We have life in our vacuum tubes. So I will try to crank it up even more. Now up to operating voltage, 220 volts. If we manage that. So at 180 volts we got 100 milliamps, and the bulb is starting to light up a bit. So there, We are at 220 volts, 127 milliamps. That's just great. Looks like nothing bad smell either. Tube is heating up, so I haven't touched any of the switches for the output yet. So we can try to see if something happens. I'm watching my current with eagle eyes here. Okay, so now my plan is to test the output from the signal generator or waveform generator. So I have soldered in a couple of leads on the backside of this connector, because I don't have a connector like this to plug in. So if you know what kind of connector this is, please let me know, because I can't find a connector like this anywhere I have looked. So I have hooked up my HP frequency counter with the beautiful Nixie tube display. And I have made a new front. This is just printed paper. So I took my broken glass and put the pieces together, and then I took a picture and then I printed the picture out. So it works for now. But if we get this signal generator to work again, I will make a new glass front for it. So as you can see here, it's a bit inverted for me, because you have the low side on this side here, then you got the high side here, so the inner scale goes from 100 to 200 kilohertz. So 100 is there and 200 is there. So yeah, and I have put the front cover back on here, so we can see what frequency we are on. And I have this mod here, so we can see if the signal generator is calibrated to these frequencies or the frequencies underneath. So I will turn down all the gain here. Then we can try to power it up and see if we get any output. Okay, so my HP frequency counter has been sitting for a while and heated up. So let's try to turn on the signal generator. So I am at operating voltage straight away. I don't bother to slowly increase the voltage now, because I know it will be okay. So turn on my isolation transformer. There. The generator is turned on. We have no frequency output now, but all the gain is turned to the bottom side. We can start with 100 to 200 kilohertz. So I have to press a bit hard on the switches here to get it to sit in the position. So we can turn up this one first. we got some reading. Can turn this one also up a bit. Or all the way. So now we see 100 kilohertz on the frequency counter. 7800, it's wobbling a bit. So I don't know if I got the dial in the accurate position here, but I have mounted it back together as it was before I took it apart. So we can try to increase the frequency. Get a quicker update rate on the counter here. 115. So we are on this scale here now. Can zoom in a bit more. 117. It's a bit wobbly. 130. So it's outputting frequency. That's great. Display says 200. So I don't expect to be right on the money here, but yeah. So 200 kilohertz there. So the first step works. So we can turn it all the way down again to 100. It started there. So we can try the 200 to 400 kilohertz. Yep, we have 200. Then we can try to increase. I'll do it a bit faster so I don't bore you with this stuff. Yeah, we get an increasing frequency, and it goes all the way to 400 kilohertz. That's good. 200 there. 100. It's wobbling a bit. Try the 400 to 800 kilohertz. 400. Now 630. It's not quite deciding on what it wants to output. And it only works at maximum millivolt range here. Increase more. So you should see about 800 there. And we don't. So more unstable at higher frequency. 800 to 1600. You can turn it down again. $440. It's all over the place. And when we turn it all the way to maximum at 1.6 megahertz, it won't display anything. 51 killer 7. I will set it to the middle range and we can try the ranges. And when we get here, it should be set the ranges, so then turning this won't have anything to say. Nothing here either, just boogles. To 7.6 megahertz. Nope, nothing. .3 to 12.5. So it looks like it don't manage to output a high frequency, and that tells me that it's most likely some caps that needs to be changed, that have dried out. And that's no wonder after all these years. And if it has been sitting in a submarine in the sea, you know, the seawater has done its job. So now we should have been at 182 kilohertz. At 200 on this plate, 200 kilohertz. And we are straight on the money, 200, and it starts to wobble again. Up. It sees 200. Let's try the next one, 245 or 260. 245. So it looks like it's calibrated after this plate here. Next one is 629 kilohertz. Have to be a bit brutal with these switches. 629, huh? Wow, that's surprising. The next one is 1312 or 1.3 megahertz. Nope. And then this says 1.43 megahertz. And we get nothing at the higher frequency. So the same sickness here as in the rest of the ranging or high frequency range. So this is the external input, utvendig. It stands for the outside, the external. So this is the output from the frequency counter signal generator. So when I equal to utvendig, external. I turn on this input here, but then I don't get any signal out, I think. Yep, yeah. Hey, I get signal out. Will it give me the higher frequencies now? It looks more stable. Nope. So it won't give me a megahertz signal. Whatsoever. But the lower frequencies works. Can we get 800 now? So we are on the 400 to 800 kilohertz. Ah, we got 700. Come on. You can do it. It's too freaking high. I'm old. So I can turn off the lights here. And you can see the paper lights up. So it's quite nice with a paper display. So, yeah, then I can just turn off the counter here. I get 664. So we got an output and we got some of the ranges in spec, and that's good sign. But the higher frequencies won't work, so my next step now is to go over all the caps and test and change everything I can find that is out of spec or too high in ESR. So yeah, if I find a obvious fault, I will turn on the camera, but just for checking and changing all the caps, it will be take too long to film everything, so I will turn it on if I get any obvious fault.